waste in the tank is a way for the everyday consumer to compete with technology.
My name is Maurice Batchelor, and I'm from Cleveland, Ohio.
And my name is Joel Griffith, and I'm from Trenton, New Jersey.
And together, we founded BotIt, a website and mobile app that uses artificial intelligence to complete online tasks. We're seeking a $150,000 investment for a 10% stake in our company.
Right now, stop what you're doing and give some super claps for Super Joel and Super Maurice. Woo! Welcome, guys. How are you doing today?
Good.
We're doing great. We're doing great. Thank you for having us. You know, we're still riding high from being on Shark Tank, so we're just excited to chat with you and talk about our experience on the show, our experience of the business post the show, prior to the show, and kind of dig into your questions.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it was just 5 days ago you guys were on Shark Tank. So, like, it was literally just yesterday. And then you guys reached out, and I happened to have a an opening available in my schedule, which is crazy because somebody canceled. So it worked out to fit you guys in so close. So thank you so much for that.
Happy to be here.
Yeah, happy to have both you guys here and talk technology. That's right in my wheelhouse on top of business. But first, we got to talk about how were you guys feeling walking down this hallway?
I don't know if my legs wouldn't stop shaking. Maurice was cool. Maurice was cool as a fan, but I was a little nervous, to be honest.
Cool as a fan. I don't know that I've heard that term before.
So with my experience with that, it was not so much the walking. So it was more along the lines of the standing there prior to when you do get a chance to walk out. People don't know this, but you're going to be sitting or standing there for about a good, I would say 2-3 minutes, just waiting for them just to say go. So, and you don't really know when they're going to say go. So you're just sitting there like, I'm ready to go. And you just got to just wait it out. So I think the walking to the out there, being in front of the Sharks, that was kind of the easy one, but actually being just waiting there backstage, just waiting to be told to walk out, that was a little bit more nerve-wracking. But yeah, as Joe said, I was really comfortable throughout the entire process of going out there, so it was fun. It was fun.
At what point did you guys get to record? Were you like first or like last of the day or?
That process is funny because you're there throughout the entire day and they do slot you. They say you're position number one, number two, three, four, et cetera. So we actually started off in position five. So we're going to be the fifth company to pitch, and then the Sharks had to go on lunch break. So after lunch break, we had to be pushed back another time. And then they had another company who had a big set. So we had to wait for them to go in front of us. So we then got pushed back another slot. So Joel and I are there all day. It's only so much that you can prep for the show, be ready and have your script done. So we had all of that ready to go. So we're just sitting there, just walking back and forth backstage, trying to go over as much as you can, but you don't really know what they're going to ask. So you're just trying to prepare as much as you can. So from my perspective, that was a little bit what I remember mostly about prior to the day of actually shooting.
Yeah, exactly. And like Maurice said, you know, we were there pretty much, man, there was a morning group and an afternoon group. The morning group had to get there 6 a.m., you know, on set, right? So we're there, we're waiting. And all I can remember is that for some reason on that particular day, everyone was getting deals, right? You get a deal, you get a deal. So I'm like nervous because I'm like, man, they can't give everyone a deal, right? It's like they're going to run out of money before they get to us, you know? They have to take a notice somebody. But luckily, you know, it just all worked out and, it was great.
Well, that is, that definitely is a, you know, aspect that I, you know, had not thought about where everybody, you know, because I've heard the opposite where, oh, the Sharks are like really testy. It's you know, it's getting towards the end of the season shooting and they all want to go on, you know, they're all ready for the break, right? They're all ready for the summer break. But to have so many people get deals right up to you and then that to actually play in your mind of like, oh, no. Are we gonna be the ones that don't get a deal?
Getting pushback definitely adds the pressure to you. Getting pushback definitely adds pressure.
So let's dive into the tank. And you know, some of the concerns that came up was the efficacy of bot usage and some of the problems that come with being a business, which is really interesting that they paired you guys up with Michael Rubin.
Crap.
Michael Rubin, like, you know, somebody who has to deal with this stuff on a probably pretty regular basis. So did you guys probably found out what, like a week or two ahead of time that Michael Rubin would be on the panel. How did that weigh in on you guys? Like, were you cognizant of his concerns with bots?
That's a good point. So when thinking of when Michael Rubin was talking about, he said it perfectly on the show. He talked about how most bots that are taking up and hoarding all of the different shoes and the drops and different things like that are businesses that are actually doing this. So it was perfect the way he described how he wants to have the bots in the hands of the customer, of the consumer, the people who actually are true fans, who actually want the drops and things like that, versus businesses who are buying them all up and using the resale to actually profit off of these purchases. So when you talk about Michael Rubin in that position there, that's where he found where we saw a relation that could help there. And also from the fact that we also work with businesses to help them automate their workflows as well. So I know consumers, golf tee times, camping, sneakers, all these different things kind of get concert tickets, get the press about bots. But you got to realize, like, consumer or businesses, they need bots as well. And the beauty about our platform is that we work on both sides. We help people from consumers, and we help businesses be able to help with their automating their process as well. So when you talk about the efficacy of bots, bots have been around for a long time. And I believe on the show, Joel kind of spoke on it perfectly, where we want to give that perception that all bots are not bad. Some bots are bad. They are stealing up the tee time. They are stealing up the new drops and things. But you can actually own a bot yourself and actually help you win back and use good bots in a good way to be able to help you win back your reservations and different things like that by using our platform.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I couldn't say even better, right? I mean, you know, like I mentioned on the show, you know, part of the reason why we were there is because we want to change the perception of bots. So we're happy to hear that. Both Michael and Mark feel the same, and we're looking forward to working with their team.
Yeah, I mean, it's I know I talked about it in my video a bit there, you know, that I actually need to deploy a bot to try to get me a hotel room for an upcoming conference.
Yeah. I heard you, not to cut you off, I heard you mention that you used a bot last year. Was that with us?
No, that was my friend did. And
your friend did, right.
Yeah, sorry. He paid like $75 or something. I'm actually gonna be hooking up with him after this because it's game night with the boys, and you know, so we're gonna be playing some Quake 2 and all. So yeah, so it's like, okay. But yeah, I think he used that visual, it was like visualping.io or something.
Okay.
And he only got one opportunity to get one room, and he had deployed it for like 3 months. So like, if he didn't have that, there's zero chance he would have had a room.
Right.
And even with that said, he only had one opportunity to get a room. So it wasn't even like he had multiple rooms to be like, oh yeah, let me divvy out to some of my friends. Cause like I would have totally took a room for that event.
And Joe, just to kind of, if you feel some sort of negative way about bots, please reach out to us. We'll talk to you about bots, how you feel about bots, and we'll get your questions answered. I know everybody's, you know, with this whole AI, you know, all these different topics that's coming up, everybody's scared of the way that bots are being ran. But there are, like I said earlier, there are negative bots out there. But if you have some sort of, you know, negative feeling towards us as a company about bot it, let us help you. Let us help answer those questions for you and be able to so you can understand a little bit more. Because as you said, Joe, you said perfect statement. There is a 0% chance that a lot of people are going to go out there and compete against the bot. And if you see in the video, you know, people are clicking refresh. People are waking up early to be able to do it. But like, we give people hope. We are giving our customers hope. We're giving the world back hope when it comes to automating their tee times, automating concert tickets, all these things that are so that become so hard to book and to purchase. We now have a solution for you. And that's where what the whole thing is, what we're trying to do and to tell people is that Bodit is here to help you be able to automate those processes and give you some hope and win back those reservations and those purchases.
So I had two thoughts. One is, well, first of all, I hope it didn't come across in my video that I was negative against Bodit. Because like I said, I'm going to deploy my own to be able to get a hotel room.
Sure.
Me personally. But I did have a thought that, you know, my wife is always checking our Disney DVC opportunities for which hotels we're able to get. So she's checking like on a daily basis.
It's annoying.
I mean, it is annoying. And I'm like, hey, you know, like that might be, I mean, I obviously that's not one of the listed things, but like, I think there's a really big opportunity there your prize part to take my DVC login and book the room that I'm waitlisted for these rooms. Right. So like, hopefully we get them. And so far we've had, you know, all full disclosure, we had a pretty good time of getting the ones we've been waitlisted for the most part. But like, if I didn't have to check it every day, like that would be helpful too.
Convenience is a big part of it. Yeah. That's another reason that we're, go ahead, Joe.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say that, you know, Joe, one thing that we're learning is that as more and more people learn about Bodit, they find different use cases to use our service, right? I mean, it started off as being, you know, pretty much, you know, for golf tee times and just little things here and there. But as we grow, it's like camping and restaurants and things like that. It's just getting more and more interesting. Pickleball is huge right now in different parts of the country, and people are reaching out to us about pickleball reservations. So, you know, the Disney one is just another good example of how when people learn more about the company, the use cases become more and more broad.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, I'm pretty confident that people are doing it even without bots, like booking up all the reservations. That's why Disney has changed their dining reservation policies and been really strict about charging that $10 per person on the reservation if they don't use it, because people are reselling these reservations, and you have up to like 2 hours before to turn it down. So they've ratcheted that down, probably because, well, I mean, people are, maybe they're using some form of a bot or not, and just like booking up as much as they possibly can. I may or may not have been guilty of not reselling, but like, because you want to keep your options open, like you're keeping it, like you just don't know where you're gonna end up. But anyway,
and that's what they're doing with most, as you said, Joe. They're doing that with just about anything, like even golf tee times or anything that the holding them until the last minute until they can become either resale or because they're just going to grow in value over time. So it's so it's that side of it that's people are doing that for sure.
That is fascinating. I know somebody who they bought tickets to go see the Phillies, like on Monday. Hey. But they bought it on Friday and they paid like an exorbitant amount of money. Oh, wow. And then those ticket prices had come down like they were like $500, came
couple
down
hours before the game.
They came out like $200 for I want to say the day of, not necessarily day of. Okay. A couple hours, but but yeah, it's just like, man, like it's like, how did all those tickets get bought up? So, you know what I mean? Like they're being resold and all that. So personally, like I could definitely see doing it. I think if you can make it easy enough for people to understand and people to deploy themselves, I think that, and you know, that's the barrier to entry. If they don't feel like, well, I had to like program this thing, or, you know, like you have the framework, but you still have to like do a lot of inputting to make it happen. That's where you're going to run into like, like I could do it. I know programming myself.
Sure.
But like, I don't have the time to do it. So it doesn't, you know, so it's like, now it becomes like, now I need to set aside 40 minutes that I don't really have to like sit down and figure this out. And that's time, you know, I always say time, energy, money. Those are the three resources we have. And time being the most important of the three just isn't there. So going into the tank, did you guys have a shark in mind that you were looking to pair with?
Just in my mind, and me and Joe kind of spoke on this. We had our discussion because we knew we were going on. But of course, Mark Cuban was the one that we had our eyes set on. So we went down the line. We did know that Michael Rubin was going to be on there. So we had him. Maybe, maybe not. He was our guest shark. But then we went down and said, all right, we know Mr. Wonderful, Kevin's not going to be in. Like, this is just doesn't seem like his type of deal that he will make. And also, it was very tech heavy. He's not really a tech heavy investor when it comes to stuff like what we're doing. And then we talk about Lori. I thought Lori, I was a 50-50 for me, just depending on how much tech she, because he seems like the average person that when it comes to using technology, it doesn't seem like she's in the dark ages with technology or anything like that. So I thought maybe that could be a play. And then also with Barbara, I didn't think Barbara would be interested. So that was, and so Mark Cuban was the one that we were, had our eyes set on, and we were hoping that we would get a deal with. And as you can tell, a lot of the conversations when we were talking with the Sharks, it was just us talking to Mark Cuban about our technology and our, and how it works and how to use it and different things like that. So that from my perspective, that was what we were kind of aiming for with the Sharks.
Yeah, for me, I was Cuban and Ruben all the way, you know? I mean, obviously Cuban for all the things that Maurice just mentioned, but you find out who or if there's going to be a guest shark, I would say about 3 weeks before before you shoot. And when I heard that it was Michael Rubin, I was excited about it. I'm like, man, it would be great to get both these guys. I just love his background, love his story, the hustle mentality. Just, you know, I'm from Trenton, Jersey. So, you know, him owning the Sixers and things like that and hearing about him, you know, so I thought that it would be a great combination and a great marriage. I was walking around seeing Cuban and Ruben 3 weeks before we even started the show, just because I was like, man, it'd be great to get both these guys. And, you know, lucky enough, you know, we were able to make the dream come true and have both those guys on our team.
Now, how did you guys come up with your initial valuation offer?
That's a great question. And I'm sure that the people you've had on this show before, no story will be the same. because this is very because of the fact, just because of the fact that, all right, so in preparation for evaluation, you first are just going to watch the show. You're going to try to say, like, all right, let me take a look at the show. What is the average valuation people are going after and all these different things? Then you see the ones that are extremely low valuation and they get good, they get the deals because of the fact that they've given them such much of the company with very little money. So that typically works. And then you have the ones that are coming with some crazy valuation. You know, in between that, things have to work out as far as what's your business and what sector are you in with your business? How much are your sales? What's your team look like? What's your growth over time? Like, how much are you spending on advertisement to acquire a customer? All those things have to kind of come into place to be able to come up with an understanding of where your valuation is. So when we took a look at it, we looked at it from a, okay, how, what are we going to do? How can we use these resources to get through the next, let's just say, 6 to 10 months? Like, we just kind of came up with some, like, all right, we know that we're not going to try to get as much money as possible. We're going to go for $5 million with a terrible valuation. And so we just didn't want to do anything ridiculous like that. So coming up with where we landed at, we were like, okay, we'll ask for 100 to 150. And then we had to think about, all right, how much do you want to give up for that? How much do you think that will be our valuation will be? So after looking at it, we kind of landed at that sweet spot where we asked for 150 for 10%. So that's kind of where we was like, all right, we're already a launched product. Botit is in the iOS App Store. You can go to our website, botit.com, sign up. So before we even knew we were on Shark Tank, we already had a product that's in the market. We already had revenue that's coming in. So we had things that are already set to give us a higher valuation. We just really needed to think about, like, all right, what's the value that a shark can now add to our business in order to make us a successful company? Because the goal here is not so much to, you know, take a check, but the goal is to say, okay, really, how can you grow your business from being on the show? How can you grow your business from partnering with the Shark to be able to help you post the show, to be able to help you with sales, marketing, and also raising money outside of the Sharks? So how can all of those things kind of play into how do you become a, what's your valuation? So those were kind of the reasons why we landed at that, where we did. Now, we did have our ceiling as well. We were like, okay, we're going to give this offer and we're only going to go up this much. And then now we kind of once, but when you're actively live in it, you're like, okay, once you get that offer, you're like, all right, like now we got an offer. We got what we're looking for. Is it something within our range? And then you try to negotiate back. But then when in our situation, when Ruben came in, that threw the whole thing off because it was like, oh, Mark Cuban, who we wanted to have as an investor, already gave us an offer. But now we have this additional, which is a better valuation. But we also still want to grab Cuban as well. So that's when we started to play into those that battle there. But it was kind of great to see that first offer come on the table. Then you just had to figure out what the next opportunity that you want to try to meet in the middle somewhere that's going to work better for the company as well as getting great Sharks involved with the business.
Yeah, and I would say plus one to everything that Maurice just said. The other thing that I would add is that, you know, this isn't Maurice's first rodeo when it comes to having a company, right? He's pretty humble, but I'm going to shout him out a little bit here. This is, I would say, his third or fourth time kind of being in this situation. I mean, first time on Shark Tank, which is a little different. But nonetheless, when it comes to, you know, valuing a company and having investors, this isn't his first time doing it. So I was taking all my cues from him because, you know, he's done this before and he knows what he's talking about. So shout out to Maurice for that.
What other kind of businesses have you had, Maurice?
Oh, that's a great question. And I love this question. I don't know if we have enough time to go over. No. So I've been, I started my first company. I started a company that, I built a mobile app that sports teams integrated inside their app to engage with fans during downtime of live events. So you may see today like DraftKings and all these other sporting products that are out there to engage with fans at any time during the day. I did this back in 2012. So this is before like when cell phones were like becoming very prominent in arenas and all this stuff and people had them and smartphones were all around and things are starting to really take off. So I built this app and at the time, my first client with that was the Cleveland Cavaliers. So they bought into it. And then after that, it just blew up. The NBA, NHL, NFL started to use this platform that I built with my own two hands. And we were able to, So that was kind of the first one. Then, so after that,
And that was sold to Dan Gilbert, by the way, right?
Yeah. So we worked with Dan Gilbert and his team, Bizum, when we closed that round with them there. Then after that, I moved out to Los Angeles, where I helped a buddy of mine start his business in the commercial real estate space, which they haven't went public or sold their company yet, but they're doing very well, and hopefully they're going down that path. There, I still have ownership in that business. So they're hopefully that they'll continue to grow and to potentially get to an exit soon. Then I helped another company start their, this went from start to finish. Well, I helped start their business and building their software where we're an IoT company where they integrated a product that worked with your water supply. It was be able to detect leaks and different things like that. So I helped build that technology out and that was sold 2 years ago. And then I also helped take the company LegalZoom public by helping them build their whole mobile division. So they went public, I want to say in 2021, 2022, around that time. I've been a part of, companies like this all the time. And my first one, like Joe was saying, we worked with the Cavaliers and Dan Gilbert and his team. And so that was my, like, you know, once I knew that I can do that, once I knew I could build something with my own two hands, take it from scratch all the way to close, that's when I knew that, hey, this is something that I'm passionate about doing. I love doing it. And so here we are with Bodit. So, you know, this is another company that I started, the ground level of it, just kind of building it out, building the proof of concept, seeing exactly what the market looked like, seeing what the competition looked like out there, understanding where we can fit in into the market. That's where I was like, you know what, this is great, because of the response that we're getting. We're really helping people. We're really helping people build bots, understand about automation. Yes, everybody hates that they're being outbeat by a bot, but now this is your time. This is your time to now say, hey, you know what, let's even the playing field. If you're a small business and you're getting like stomped out by bigger businesses because they got all this money that can invest into automation, come to us. Come to us. Let us help you out. Let us help you with your automation. If you're getting outbeat with trying to get your golf tee times or concert tickets, come to us. You don't have to go through that anymore, because we're going to help you get your help you win back your reservations and your purchases.
No, I love it. That is a heck of a resume there as well.
So Joe, you may have noticed a pattern. You have Dan Gilbert from the Cleveland Cavaliers, you got Mark Cuban from the Mavericks, and you have Michael Rubin, who used to own the Sixers. So apparently Maurice has a thing about working with owners of basketball teams. So
hopefully one day I can get on my own basketball team.
There we go.
Hey, I mean, you know, you don't have to be the 100% owner. You could be, you know, a minority owner.
Give me 1%. I'll be all right with that. I'll take that.
Not impossible. So speaking of all those things that you have going on, Maurice, or have had going on over the years, how did you prepare, you know, how did you both of you prepare for Shark Tank while balancing, you know, your business body as well as any other endeavors that you have going on?
I like this question. I like this. Joe, you can start if you want to.
Well, I'll just say, you know, we spent a lot of time, you know, watching older shows and learning about what works, what doesn't work, learning the personalities of the sharks, things like that. We created a Google Doc of all the sharks, where they're from, what's their background, what their businesses are, how they made their millions, things like that, how long they've been on the show. We wanted to know a little bit about everyone so that if we needed to bring those things up during the conversation to, you know, show that we've done our homework, that we could. But then also just, you know, making sure that we had our story down packed to a certain way that would be easy enough for them to understand and to digest that what we're doing. And, you know, it took a lot of time. You know, the process for us started maybe about 3 months before we actually hit the stage. Maurice and I are lucky enough to both live in Los Angeles. So we were able to see each other pretty often and have conversations about our strategy and about, you know, what we're going to say on the show and working together to come up with the pitch. It was a long and strenuous process. We reached out to other people who were on the show. I have a friend of mine. His name is Syed. He is the one of the founding partners over at Blue Land. Who did a deal with Mr. Wonderful. So he was very helpful with the preparation for the show as well. We had a couple of Zoom calls with him. So it was just a lot of just, you know, understanding the things that we would need to know and making sure that we had every T crossed and I dotted before actually going through those doors.
Yeah. That Joe brings, and also Joe forgot to mention he has a beautiful, how old is Ella? 3 years old?
She's two.
So the balance of that, you know, that's a lot. That's a lot to deal with. So you know, having your kids involved and things like that is important because you have to balance that. And so my perspective of this, Joe, this is crazy because like a lot of people who are prepping for Shark Tank, they're pre-revenue. They don't even have a product. They don't even have technology. They have nothing. So, you know, their whole time, they're just prepping for Shark Tank, which is fine, which is fair. That's a great time for you to put your product out there. You want to deliver the best you can. But just as you mentioned, when you asked the question, we had a business to run. So, you know, my job as CEO and founder of the company is to make sure everything is still streamlined and customer. I'm dealing with customers all the time. I'm dealing with investors all the time. So, like, I'm dealing with all these different things left and right. And yes, also we have to prepare for Shark Tank. And also, yes, I do have a family. I have a 14-year-old son. So, like, so all of these different things that kind of played into that. I just didn't. And some other companies, they have a ton of other investments. So, like, they're like, ah, Shark Tank. If I get it or I don't get it, that's fine. I got a ton of money in the bank anyway, so I don't really need to prep for it that much. And whatever happens, happens. Some people had that perspective of it, and which was not our case. We're a very, very, and for the people who are watching this, Bodit is a very, very scrappy team. We didn't go out and say, hey, we want to make sure that we got a ton of money to hire every single engineer that's out there. No, we're a small team and we're building this directly for you, the consumer. We want to make sure that that continues throughout our journey. So to answer your question, Joel, yes, it was a big balance of preparing for the show. Joel and I meeting almost on a daily basis, if not in person, we're meeting on Zoom or something like that to kind of talk through, go over the pitch, go over potential questions that could be asked, all these different things that we're kind of trying to hedge our way and figure out the best way that you can. Then you got a family side. My son was amazing. He helped us go through the pitch. He was pretending like he was a shark at times to kind of say, like, all right, like, here's how you, you know, to ask, answer questions and try to be as, you know, make it as hard as possible. So he was very, very helpful. And also my girlfriend, she was amazing as well. She helped kind of put all of this together as far as helping with the, assembling all of the stuff, like what we're going to wear, well, all these different things as far as preparation for that. Then we had a ton of friends who were helping us with the script, helping us with all of these different things to kind of help prepare us for the show. So that's the show part of it. Then you talk about, like, you still got a business to run. So on the business side, that was a little bit more difficult because of the fact that you have to continue to give your customers your attention. That's honestly most important part of me and Joel and our business, is to make sure our customers are being taken care of. So going through and making sure that we spend time to focus on that is was definitely our priority. And as you see, at the end of the day, it worked out. You know, we got how everything aired, and how everything, the deal that we got, all the different things that kind of went into place, kind of worked itself out. So, you know, and the response that we're getting. So, so if you're watching this right now, you know, it doesn't change. We're still going to work with you one-on-one and make sure that you get your bot set up the way you need it, and then make sure that you get the best experience you can by using our service.
Now, how did you guys end up getting connected with Shark Tank? Did they reach out to you, or did you end up applying?
Yeah, so we applied. You know, there was a friend of mine who I know who said to me, like, man, you guys should really take a look at this opportunity. It could be something good for you guys. And we went through the process, and I would say about a month or so later, we got an email back saying, you know, hey, we've seen your application. This looks pretty good. We're interested. We're going to have you guys fill out this really long and extensive document, which we did. And after that led to them inviting us to do a pitch in which we needed to record. So we recorded that pitch. It was much longer than we wanted, but it got to the point. Then after that, we got hit up from a couple of producers, and you know, those guys, shout out to Javi and Steve. I'd like to shout those guys out because they were awesome, from the ABC/Shark Tank team. And the rest is history.
Yeah. That was to Joel's point. And it was funny because when we did create that script initially, I don't even think we memorized it. We had like a TV.
Oh, yeah.
We had the camera in the back, and then, yeah. The camera was back, and then we had a TV kind of like, so it looks like we're looking at the camera, but had a script. Right. When we were doing it, but yeah, we had this long script, but as Joe said, it worked out. You know,
they don't give you much time. They don't give you much time, Joe. No. So it's like, hey, you know this, you know, write us, send us a script and then perform it, right? Like a week later, it's just like, we did not have it memorized, but it worked out.
Yeah. And then once they do help you a lot, as Joe mentioned, our producers' names who were assigned to us, who actually helped us with the show, they helped us break down the script. And then Joe, I mean, since we had the opportunity, we went to work. We really did. Once we knew this was a potential opportunity for us, we went to work. We practiced every day. We made sure that we went over the potential questions that would ask. Joel mentioned that we had a document that was out there to kind of go over. If you're, and honestly, you need to do that. If you're a small business owner and you're looking for investors, definitely make sure that you know the background of your investors. Know every detail about them as best as you can. If they're not investing in, if you have a automation company like Bodit, and you're trying to pitch to somebody who opens up fast food chains, then they may not know so much about your business. So make sure that you have the knowledge of your investors, because that's going to work out with you in the long run. And they'll know that they're able to help you along the way with your business. And also they'll understand what your business is.
Yeah. I mean, it is really important, because like otherwise people start, you know, can get frustrated because they feel like they're not like a part of it, or they're not helping enough, or, you know, and then the whole human aspect just like seeps into it. And then next thing you know, they're like, you know, you're having arguments over things that aren't really things you should be arguing about, because you've all should have done your research ahead of time and had a pretty good idea of where your strengths are. To make the team move forward, even if that person isn't involved on the day-to-day operations of it.
And I hope people know that, and to your question back to how do we get on the show, there are 30,000, we learned that 30,000 applicants apply each season. So every time though, you're one of the 30,000 applicants that's going out there. So to get through that process, I mean, it's a lot and it's a long process. So just, you know, we're glad that we snuck through and was able to get on the show. But it's very challenging. So we're glad that we were able to get through.
And something that I learned that was pretty interesting was that there was a woman who was in the green room with us. And I don't believe her episode aired yet, so I'm not going to talk too much about it. But she was, I think she applied. This was like her 12th time applying. And she finally, and she finally made it through. So to Maurice's point, 30,000, you know, applicants, you know, some people applying for the third, fourth, fifth time, whatever the case may be, you know, but for us to, this being our first time applying, making it all the way from beginning to end, you know, really just, you know, speaks to the product and what Maurice built. And we're just really looking forward to just continuing to spread the gospel about Bodit and helping people.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, Kimberly Meckwood, I think it was her like seventh or eighth time applying. The Action Glow brothers, they had, I don't know, they had applied like seven or eight times themselves. You know, starting when they were kids, and I mean, they're still relatively kids, probably like 18, 19, 20 years old, but when they were kids. So, it is a huge honor, regardless of if you apply or if you're, you know, found and selected via their own internal processes. You know, because there is a lot of, I mean, there's so many businesses out there, even ones that aren't applying, right? Because you're competing against people, you don't even know who you're competing against, because the producers are always looking for new, interesting businesses that could bring something different to television and make for great TV and hopefully land a deal and bring, you know, keep them and, you know, keep the Sharks interested to stick around for another season, keep them in a job for another season, the producers, right? Because if you're bringing junk to the table all the time, like what good's that doing, right? So speaking of all that, you guys hadn't really dived into, like, were you guys big fans of the show prior to applying to be on the show?
I was absolutely. You know, my family and I would watch, you know, every season. Between Shark Tank and Jeopardy, we would just sit there and just and watch pretty often. So, yeah, I was a huge fan.
Yeah, I was quite the opposite. I wouldn't say that I was not a fan of the show, but I did not watch it that much. It was something that, you know, something that I just really needed to really understand how the show works. So, you know, I had to sit back and watch a ton of episodes and try to figure all of that out. You know, I guess I wouldn't call myself not a fan of it, but I didn't really watch it as much. I heard of it. I did catch episodes previously throughout time. People were sending me things about different companies that's on there. So, like, being able to see that I was on the show and or that we were going to go on the show, I had to really just study up on it. And you know, I started to prior to it, I would say I watched Shark Tank so much just to kind of prep for the show. So, you know, I started to become more of a fan of it and really enjoy the show. And it started to grow on me. So, yeah. So I think that, you know, just kind of to start out, I was not such a big fan and didn't really know much about it, but it really started to grow me. And so, like, now I'm starting to become a fan of it, which is great for me because I have 15 seasons now to binge watch. So, you know, so it's it was great to kind of get involved with that on the, now that I've been on the show and more of a fan of it.
Oh, that's interesting to hear. I mean, I've known a few people that have come through that have been on the show that had never watched the show before.
And,
you know, that just, you know, or, well, at least one that never even knew the show existed prior to it. Yeah, right.
Well, that's crazy.
If you don't watch TV, how or regularly?
No, but like, you gotta know that the show exists.
Yeah, exactly. Like, come on.
I mean, I know two people that had no idea what I was talking about when I was talking about sharks. They thought I was actually talking about sharks in a tank, and they were like, "What are you watching? What are you doing?"
People get that with me with Seinfeld. They're like, "Oh, wait, you never watched Seinfeld before?" I'm like, I've heard of the show, but I've never watched really. I know people, your fans are going to hate me now, but I was like, no, I've never really I never really watched Seinfeld. That was not my thing. But, you know,
Well, Joe, the people who didn't know about Shark Tank, were they from a different country? Do they call it, because they call it Lion's Den?
Nope.
Right?
Nope. No, gotcha. I understand where you're getting at, but no, they would not. I mean, we have plenty of international viewers here at the channel, and they all seem to know, you know, that it's not Lions, it's Dragon's Den.
Dragon's Den. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. These people just had no idea. And I was talking because they were like asking, like, oh, I see you have some kind of YouTube channel or something going on. So I'm like, I'm talking about it. Like, well, what do you do during it? And you know, it's explaining, and they're like, oh, okay. And that, like, the one dude's wife was like, oh, what you don't know what Shark Tank is? Like, right. What are you talking about?
Gotcha.
So wow. So there are people out there that are just so buried in their bit, like their bit, and it's a business owner at that.
Right,
so,
right.
Guess they're not watching CNBC on the weekends because that's like all they replay. Or yeah, MSNBC? Yeah. MSNBC.
MSNBC,
right? Yeah. So but anyway. Once you guys got out of the tank, you got yourself a deal. Obviously, you have to go through the process, due diligence, and all that.
Yep.
But how did you? And obviously, you don't know when you're going to air until like 2-3 weeks prior. But how did you guys go about preparing for Shark Tank? To potentially be airing. So in your case, it's all digital. So like, what did you beef up the website, or did you, you know, what kind of preparations did you take in case you did happen to air?
Right. So that's a great question. So from a technology standpoint, yes, you have to be prepared to beef up the website. But in order to beef up the website, you got to make sure that it's being hosted on a proper platform that can beef up your website. So if you're, you know, looking at Vercel, or if you're looking at AWS, or if you're looking at all these other different options that you can choose from, or Azure. So like, you just want to make sure that your website is in a place where you can scale it up. So the website, yes, we needed to make sure that our website, database, all these different things, prepare for attacks and all these different things to make sure the security is correct. So we did that. So we were able to make sure that the website we were able to be able to handle the scale. Also, we needed to make sure that that we updated our website to kind of be presentable at that stage where we wanted to have millions coming to our website. So back even in July, we started working on our botted interface where we wanted to brush up on our main website, our mobile app. So the team went to work. We worked with designers. We worked with a bunch of other teams. We worked with this company called By All Means. By All Means kind of helped us. They're an agency that does a lot of mobile development. They do graphic designs. They were super helpful. They were amazing. And they helped us get to the level where we're at, today with our mobile app and our website. So shout out to them, because they did a lot of the updated designs. And please check out bodit.com. That's By All Means is the company that did all that and kind of helped us get it together. And we've gotten such a great response from it. So it's pretty cool. So the preparation from a technology standpoint, there it is. So the preparation from that standpoint was very, very important. We wanted, and Joel mentioned this earlier, we were, we only were focused on tee times a lot earlier. So a lot of our stuff was tailored toward tee times, but we work with other companies, work with other services. So now we added all of those other, introduced tennis, pickleball, camping, restaurants, concerts. Now it's able to be able to scale up to many different types of opportunities for people to set up bots. And they're all affordable. So that's something that we wanted to make sure that we maintain when going on the show, is that when we introduced our product to the world, that people understood that this is something that they can afford and that there's something that they can use. So, yeah, it was a lot of preparation for that, just as you mentioned, Joe, that timeline of, hey, you're going to be on Shark Tank. You don't know the air date. But hey, here's your 3-week notice that you're going to be on Shark Tank. So, yeah, we went immediately to work once we knew that was going to happen. And we didn't know the air date back in July or anything like that, because you said 3 weeks in advance. So, but we just was, our mindset was, we're going to air tomorrow. So like in July, that was our mindset. So we just went to work right after that.
Yeah. And there's no such thing as an easy rebrand, right? If you would have seen I'm not sure if you saw our website prior to us going on Shark Tank, but we knew that it was a good website, but it was something that we wanted to improve to make sure that when our customers visit our site, they have a clear understanding of what we're offering, what we're serving, if you will. And then we wanted to try to improve our user journey so that the bot creation process was more streamlined. I mentioned the team over at By All Means. Shout out to Anna, shout out to Luke. Shout out to those guys for helping us make that process more seamless.
No, and it looks great, right? Like I thought it's definitely one of the better websites that I've come across.
We got the Joe approval.
We got the Joe approval.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Here's a fun fact about that.
What's that?
We went live on that website the morning. The morning of the show airing was when we went live with that website.
We were hesitant. We were like, should we do it? But I was like, let's push it. Let's do it. We're risk takers. We worked so hard to get to this point. Why hold anything back? We made sure we tested it out to make sure we can scale up. So we ran tests and stuff like that. But for the most part, it was the day of. Post show technology wise, there were some things that we wanted to make sure that we figured out. So there's some small things that we had to change up to improve the stability of the site. But everything has turned out great. Everything is up running live. You can set up your bots start to finish. You can download the mobile app, and you can go on our website and use our service to be able to set that up.
And Joe, you'll be happy to know that we're going to be adding the social channels at the bottom of the site.
Yeah.
So, I know that's
something. Make it a little easier for me, please.
Make it a little easier for you. And then also we're going to add
How much is Joe paying us for that?
I just had to do a Google search, find it. And that's we find stuff like that all the time though here on the channel, because it's the lot, it's usually that night, unless it's a past episode. And then
but also Joe, find things like that. The Bodit Instagram that you pulled up on your show last time, that's actually not us. Our Instagram is
Are you serious? It looks
that's not us. Our Instagram is bodit.automation.
Chris Ward was like the same logo.
No, that wasn't us.
Was it different?
Because that one had like Burger King. That one looked like it was something for like food delivery service or something along those lines.
Yes.
If you can pull it up now on Instagram if you want to. It's a
body.automation.
I'm pulling it up right
now.
We can
share that one with your audience as well.
It looks much better than the other body.
Much better than the other one. Yeah. No offense to whoever that is. There.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I think it was body app, which I thought was weird that you guys didn't have anything for Shark Tank on there.
Right.
So we're
in the process too of just doing a rebrand on this as well. We have some people who've been working on this for the last couple of years, but you know, we're going to add our rebrand logo and things like that to the aesthetic of the actual page. But we do have the videos from Mike and Mark on the top there. There's a great video there of Mike talking about why he invested in the company, or why he, you know, decided to do the deal with the company. Then of course we have a video there that's pinned at the top of our founder Maurice, just basically talking about what Bodit is and his vision for the company. So, you know, a lot of work to do on this page as well, but I just wanted to make sure that you had the right page.
Well, you know what, but that just goes to show you why it's so important to have the social media linked on it. I went found it and I found the wrong one. I don't have a lot of time. Look, I shoot these videos the night that they air. Right.
Yeah.
So I'm shooting them right at you guys walked out first. Your pitch was live online before the episode was over. Or just about. I think I ran into the tail end of your pitch ran long, so I had to like do a little, you know, movie magic and chop some it up to get through the copyright system. But I don't have time necessarily dig into it. So I'm like, what do you got there? And if you got nothing, then I'm like going to, like, maybe just do a quick search on TikTok or Google search, and what I found was what I found, and like. That also was a lesson in that as well, right? Of this is what I found as a user.
Yeah.
Right. And we're always looking for feedback on stuff like that.
For sure.
If you reach out to us, your fans that are watching now, reach out to us. We're always want to improve our service. We want to improve our stability on everything. So give us feedback.
Yeah.
Right. And that's what this is about, right? Not to like roast anybody I found lots of like little bugs and things like, oh, I'm clicking on it. And none of the social media links are linked to anything. It's like, or you, two of them are, but one isn't, or one's linked to something else. Like it's just a mistake. Right. But that sucks when it's so much traffic being sucked to the site all at once. And, you know, you have misinformation or something. Joe, what were you going
to
say?
No, I was just going to say, it just speaks to just like, you know, being entrepreneurs, right? I mean, we're trying to, like Maurice said earlier, we're bootstrapping this whole operation, and it's just, you know, our team is really small and we're working to do our best. So we'll work on the SEO to make sure that when Bodit is put into Google, that will be the, you know, of course, the people that pop up when that time comes. But those things cost money, right? So, you know, we'll get there.
No, absolutely. So did you guys end up having a watch party? Were you together for the watch party? Was it separate? Like,
absolutely. We, if you know anything about us, we're going to do everything big. So, like, we had a huge watch party out here in LA. We had a little bit over 100 people come to our watch party. So everybody showed up, and it was funny because, like, when the show actually aired, you know, you're only on for 6 to 8 minutes. So everybody's drinking, having a good time prior to the show. And then when the time is on, everybody's all quiet and everybody's looking. But it was perfect because, like, we were the first ones on. And then also when it built up the hype, they were like, because when Mark made that his initial offer, and then Michael came in, and then they were like the battle of the like, and then it cut to commercial. Then everybody went crazy. So that was a fun experience to have all the family, friends, neighbors, just everybody here, just enjoying a great time and seeing their person that they know personally on Shark Tank and presenting to the world and debuting it, because they know all the hard work that's been put on. So Yes, we had a viewing party, and yes, we had the most amazing time at our viewing party.
Oh, I love that. I love that. Can you speak to how the sales and traffic, did you get to track any of that? As well, because you guys are on the West Coast, right? So
yeah,
did you guys air it? Did you guys show it East Coast time, or did you wait until West Coast air?
We waited West Coast time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we waited West Coast time to air it just because of the party. We were like, we'll start it at 6 o'clock, which is already, it's already aired. It airs at 5 p.m. their time. So we just, waited till 8 o'clock p.m. Pacific Standard Time to show it on the TVs. Nobody really cheated and watched it prior to besides myself.
I didn't get a chance to watch it fully, but my parents are still in New Jersey, so I FaceTimed them while it was on and got a chance to listen to it a little bit before it came on. I thought it was pretty cool.
I wasn't going to cancel the viewing party, but I wanted to make sure that we weren't too edited, because you don't know how it's going to edit.
Yeah,
you just don't know how they're going to edit it. So like, I cheated a little bit and watched it prior to, but it ended up being great. Like when I saw it for the first time, I was like, all right, I can chill now. Like I can chill for this party. I can chill for this party now. Like I could just relax and just now see the part. I just enjoy the party because I know that the airing is going to be great. So
yeah, I had to I was so anxious to know like how they would edit it, right? Because you know, the editing team really can make you or break you. You know what I mean? Like, you know, so we were there. The conversation was obviously much longer than what was shown. Oh, and there were things in there that kind of were like, oh, they edited that to make that seem like a little bit, you know, whatever, whatever. But, you know, I just had to know what they were going to say. And it was perfect though.
Yeah. So good job, editing team.
Good job to the ABC editing team.
Absolutely, they have world-class editors, and they do a really good job of, for the most part, making I think people look really good, even when things aren't necessarily going so well in the tank. But you're so from a traffic and sales point of view, like, so you got that push, which I think it was smart to start your party at 6, right? So people would have a good time pre-gaming and stuff prior to the Super Bowl commercial. That's when it gets quiet, right? During the game, everyone's talking loud. I'm like, I'm trying to watch the game. And then all of a sudden, everyone gets quiet because the commercial comes on. I'm like, oh, God, I could just watch that on YouTube. Like, what the hell?
But sales, you had a question about sales.
Did they meet? I mean, you don't have to talk about specific numbers, but like, did it meet your expectations? Did it or exceed them? Or was it, you know, more like, was it just more traffic people going to find out? Because I don't know, you know, some businesses, it's an unnecessarily a today thing. Like, oh, the guy that was growing diamond rings and stuff or diamonds, right? It's like, not everybody needs a diamond ring today. But now that they've been there and they know it exists, it's in their back pocket for when they do need it.
So, Joe, everybody needs a bot. It's now going on 2024. There is so much automation that people need just for not so much the competition part of it, but just for convenience as well. So to answer your question, we got a huge amount of inquiries about our service from consumers as well as businesses. Revenue really shot up. And went to a really high number. What do we have? I think on the first episode, we've had over 50 new subscriptions, which was going to bring in about $10,000 in annual recurring revenue. And that's just for the East Coast. So we started to see much more after that when it came to revenue from when we aired on the West Coast. So this weekend, even today, we are still seeing so much customers come in, new registrations. We have thousands and thousands of new registrations of people signing up. So like we are seeing the traffic come in. We're seeing the subscriptions come in. We're seeing the revenue come in. So Shark Tank does work. Shark Tank does work. But you got to be prepared for Shark Tank. You just can't. That's why I told you in July, we were thinking that we were pretending that we were airing tomorrow because we were preparing for this day. We wanted to make sure that everything was in order. We had all of our ducks in a row and all those things to make sure that we are prepared to, if we do see the traffic we're expecting, we can capitalize on it. So, it's been great to see all of the people reaching out to us. Joel mentioned earlier that we've been getting so much stuff that we haven't even thought about for a bot. And we can do it. The whole reason that we exist, we build customized bots for businesses and consumers. So your bot is going to be built no matter what your situation is. And we can help you with that by, whatever you need for your business or for consumers.
So a question that comes to mind though is like Google's CAPTCHA, right? Like version 3 specifically. I don't want you to give away the secret sauce, but like, can you talk to how you're getting around that? Like,
I can't talk about this joke. So we do have, so my background is I work with a lot of things of being able to maneuver around those type of situations. So there are scripts that I've built in order to get around CAPTCHA. So we're not actually, so when people are like, you got to get past CAPTCHA, that's true, but we don't get around it in a way where we're clicking on the little checkbox and we're checking off the little pictures what you were talking about, version 3 of reCAPTCHA, you don't actually have to see the pictures anymore. They just kind of are able to detect if you're a human versus, yep. Because it's a score. It's a score. It's what they do. It is a score. So it's how you move, how you type something in, or how did you
scary
get to this
thoughts,
place?
By the way, that they're attracted to that degree.
Yeah. They really can get to it. So like, there are things that we have to do that we've done, the scripts that we've been able to build in order to get around all of that. That's why all of our bots go undetected when customers are using our service. So to answer your question on the reCAPTCHA though, we just have scripts that are built in order to for us to be able to maneuver around those, but not in any malicious way. Please read our FAQ. We don't do anything that's not outside the standard practices. There are standard practices from a federal as well as a state laws that for the way you can use automation. So you can do different attacks. You can try to steal information. You could try to all these different things, but we decline bots for people who sign up and say, hey, I want you to do this voter fraud thing for me. And we're like, no, this is not something that, or I want you to make me a YouTube star. Like, no, we're not going to set up bots for you to become a YouTube star or to you to get views. So like, if you're good enough to do that, I don't say this to our customers, but if you're good enough to do that, you should be able to do that just from your talent for your work. So we make sure that we follow all the standard practices when it comes to automation, but we build scripts and different things like that for us to be able to go undetected, to be able to get past the different CAPTCHAs. And there's different stuff than other than reCAPTCHA. So one thing I will say, I am upset that people don't know this, but CAPTCHA was built by Google. So CAPTCHA they're 100% developed by Google. So what they did was like, Google is a bot. People don't know this, but Google is a bot and it goes through all these different websites to be able to pull information and all this and scrape it. And then it presents it to you when you search something on Google. So Google, what they did is if your site has reCAPTCHA on it, you can actually use that. And it's going to actually say, hey, no, you're if it's a Google bot, they're going to know how to get past it immediately. But if you're not, then they're going to do that. So people don't realize that when it comes to bots, Google is the one who actually built that service. And, so it's kind of it's for them to build a monopoly when it comes to automation. But, it's intelligent people that can get around those things. And hopefully they're using it in a good way, like what we're doing here at Body.
I was going to ask that about the people using your technology for malicious,
purposes. We don't do it.
Assume, but you know what assuming. So.
Yeah, so like I said, all new bots, some of our bots do build themselves. Like I would say like 80%, 70 to 80% of our bots do build themselves, but some of them do require us to approve it. So like I said, voter fraud, anything malicious like that, we have no intentions of doing it. Keep your money, we don't want to do it. And then we just want to make sure that we're providing a great service for all customers who actually do need automation to provide whatever problems they're facing.
Mm. So how did you guys come across my video?
Yeah. So my cousin, actually, Dawn Washington, she was sent the video, and I believe that she commented on the video with me in it. And so she sent it to me. I said, oh, wow, this is pretty cool. And I thought that you had a very fair and straightforward assessment of the pitch. So kudos to you for that.
Thank you.
And when I saw, and when I saw that you had the wrong Instagram page, I said, you know, this would be a good opportunity for us to go on and just talk to the people, and, you know, explain the business, and then also make sure that they had the right place to find us. So that's how I came across your video.
My son sent it to me, like, pretty much, like you said, it was that same night. I'm like, how did you even find it? This is so quick, but he sent it to me. And so that's how I came across it.
Yeah. Oh, well, you know, hey, look, everything happens for a reason, and having the wrong Instagram, you know, prompted you to say, you know, maybe I should go and reach out so we can set the record straight and have a great conversation about bots and business and Shark Tank and everything in between. So I'm glad that you guys found the video and found it, you know, I don't know about entertaining, but educational enough.
It was entertaining. It was entertaining. It was interesting, at least from my perspective, to see how someone else felt about just to give their opinion on our appearance, right? So you know, like I said, I thought it was fair, and it was pretty cool. So you know, we're happy to come and chat with you.
Oh, thank you. This is pro entrepreneur here, not pro shark. And this is not a shark historian or anything like that. So it is very much about teaching other people how to be. And I'm learning too, right? Because I'm not in the bot building business. I'm not in the CPG spit. Like I'm in other businesses. But, you know, when it comes to numbers and thought and theory and stuff like that, like I'm here for it, you know, and I'm here to learn as much as to teach and to color in the lines in between to help other entrepreneurs become super entrepreneurs and be the best version of themselves for others. So so growing up, guys, what was your childhood dream growing up?
That's a good question. I always I'm gonna be honest, I love basketball. I played basketball my entire life. But
going for three opportunities with three different basketball teams. I couldn't.
But I always loved computers. Like I always, you know, since I was, you could tell my mother would say, like, we had our Apple computers growing up and all that. I would fix them and I would be more concerned about breaking them and putting them back together when I was 6-7 years old. And when I was in elementary school, I was working with, you know, our computer service teams. They were getting paid. I was just sitting around, you know, working on the printers and putting them together. And then as I gotten older, I started my own computer service business eighth, ninth grade, around that time. And I used to go around and put up flyers about fixing computers. And I had my first little business fixing computers. And so that was kind of like, I just love technology and working with that. So I was always born to be an engineer. I was always born to build software. I know 8 different software languages. That's something that I'm really happy to do. But I want to challenge the world. Can anybody else code as well as dunk a basketball? That's a hard combination. I think that people can that people don't know can actually do. So I want to hear the people's comments if that can be possible. But no, technology is something that I always knew that I'll be a part of. Granted, you have your I want to be a NBA player and all that, but you know, technology kind of always came very early on, and I'm still doing it to this day. So I would say that I am living a dream. I am I'm fulfilling it, and I'm very happy to do this. I love coding 38 hours a day. So, you know, it's something that I enjoy doing. So, so that's kind of how I figure out me growing up and working in technology.
Yeah, I would say for me, I mean, I've always been a tech nerd, more so software than hardware. I wasn't taking computers together and putting them back together like, but as far as software is concerned, I was always, you know, tinkering and playing with different technology and learning how to download, implement things like just at a really, really early age before the internet was what it is right now. I'm 37. So you're talking about, you know, 20 plus years ago of just doing these things. Over 20 plus years. But I would say I always wanted to be involved in public service. It was always my dream to either be an elected official or like a mayor, you know, a governor or something along those lines, you know, basically in the executive branch, you know, helping work or working with the legislative branch to implement policy. Before working in tech, I spent about 10 years working in Capitol Hill, working for people like Senator Chuck Schumer, Congresswoman Bonnie Watson Coleman, who's the congresswoman currently in Princeton, Trenton, New Jersey, where I'm from. So, you know, that was always had that passion to actually help people more so on the ground and like state and local, more so than like on the federal level. Didn't want to be like U.S. Senator or president or anything like that. I was always focused on like being in the state and local to try to help people who are directly on feet on the ground. So a little bit of a pivot, I guess, from, you know, being an elected official. But, you know, the good news with this company is that we are helping people in some form or fashion through allowing them to create bots to compete with some of the other people who have bots. So a little bit of a public service flavor added to this.
No, absolutely. Well, both of you guys are speaking my language. Joel, was SimCity, and I guess Maurice as well, was SimCity part of your childhood as much as it was of mine?
Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely.
For Oregon Trail for me.
Oregon Trail. Really? It's not SimCity not with Sim all the, City for some the reason. Wanting yeah. to like be mayor yeah. and things. Like literally no, be mayor not, in yeah. the game.
There was Oregon another Trail one. Oregon
Trail too, because my older brothers played that, yeah.
Yeah, Oregon Trail. I don't know why that one just stuck with me. Of course, I'm showing my age here. We all are, right? But
no, I'm 37 too. So we're all, okay, cool. We're all good.
Yeah. So, but yeah, Oregon Trail definitely. SimCity, I played it a little bit. For some reason, it didn't stick with me. I don't know.
Oh man, Will Wright, man, he helped change my life. Yeah. You know, it's funny. Like you guys talking about, you know, computer. I'm like I grew up around computers from the age of 6 years old, and I think it was by the age of like. Well, by 10, I was coding and building websites and stuff like that. So, like, when people talk about blogging and stuff, I'm like, yeah, I've been doing it since, like, 96, 97. So, yeah. Like, you know, it's not different to me. It's not something I'm learning or trying to learn. Content creation just comes naturally. But, I mean, and on the tech side, you know, I was in the tech department as well, Maurice, and very much in high school, we had one. So that's where I spent a lot of high school hours there. But like, you know, going back to like Windows 95 and Windows NT, like I actually would dual boot Windows NT and 95 so that I could get a faster connection out of my 56K modem, because it would connect like 10 or 11K faster than when I used Windows 95 and connected. Or was it 95 or 98? It might have been 98. I think it was 98 and NT, but yeah, you know, so it, you know, so I you know, I'm it, you guys are one for my heart. I had
a Dell Dimension 4400 Pentium 4 processor, 256 megabytes of RAM. That was my first one that I was like, you know what, this is. That was an amazing computer to me because that was the fastest I've ever had. This was back in 01, maybe 2000 or something like that.
For me, it was a gateway computer.
They still make gateway computers.
They still make gateway.
They do. A friend of mine, one of my friends, so actually the one that about the hotel thing, he just bought a gateway laptop because it was like $400, but it has like a game, you know, an RTX 3050. Wow. It's a gaming laptop for like $420. And I'm like, I should have bought two of them for my kids. So I don't have to look around their computers to these LAN parties that we're going to. So, Well, wait. I was going to search something. You said, wait. What were you saying, Maurice? That you
the Dell Dimension?
Oh, the Pentium.
Pentium four. Intel processor.
Was that in 04? It was 2000. Was it 2000? Yeah, 2000 came out.
That sounds about right. Yeah.
I thought it was later than that. I thought it was like, no, closer they, to they like
came, that's Pentium D,
two I think, or I think three.
I think it's the Intel Pentium D that came out. I don't remember. Yeah, it's around those times.
Were shipped from November 2020, 2000 to August 8, 2008, and it was removed the official press. Interesting. I had one as well. That was, I want to say it was either Northwood or Prescott, maybe both, because it was before hyper threading started with Northwood and Prescott. Yeah. So, yeah, all right, anyway, we're going down. but that's what happens on podcasts, right? What's the future of Bodit looking like for you guys?
That's a great question. The future of Bodit. So, if we're talking from a branding standpoint, we want to get the word out there about what our service is, who we're working and how we're changing the world, how we're putting a bot in every home and every business, but for a good way. So where we look to take Bodit is to continue to follow that principle. We want to help educate people on how to set up a bot, how that they need a bot, and how we're not here to make things worse, but we're here to make things better to help you. And Barbara put it great on the show, to even the playing field when it comes to automation. Yep. So that's kind of where we want to take Bodit in the future. Of course, we want to continue to grow out our B2B, expand out our team. So if you're a good salesperson, if you think that you can sell automation and you know that, please let us know. Reach out to us at operations@bodit.co. And we're able to, we'll take in your resume and see if that's something that from a sales perspective, because we're hiring those positions. So just expanding out our company and continuing to grow revenue. And hopefully you'll hear one day that, Bodit is integrated into one of the bigger players in the technology field. And, we look to take it to that level.
Yeah, no, I can't say better. I mean, basically, we just want to continue to change the perception of bots, and working with Mike and Mark's team to help do that, to continue to educate consumers on bot technology, continue to streamline the bot creation process. We have a long way to go before it's perfect. That's our goal.
Well, I guess my question to that would be, are you worried about, integrating with other companies and then having them not do the bad things, or having them go and do the bad things and regulate that?
Maybe I shouldn't have spoke on that because I don't know what we're going to do and if that actually presents itself. Because to your point, we're focused on the next 8 to 10 months. We're not going to be integrating inside some other company in the eight to 10 months unless the money is there. You never know. But for the most part, like right now, we're focused on working for the consumer and getting the general public, the 99% of people who don't know how to set up a bot. Our goal is to reach out to those customers, be able to get their business, get their whatever that they're looking to automate all set up. We don't work with any third party. When you're looking to book golf tee times, we don't work with your golf facility. If you're looking to book for get concert tickets, we don't work with your wherever you're buying the concert tickets. We work solely on ourselves, like by our own in our own environment. So please, make sure that we won't sell your information. We're not going to link it to some other system. This is something that you're going to work directly one-on-one with us. All the other stuff, we got all of those middle people out the way to be able to help stop it. That's we don't follow any of those rules. We're the bad boys of automation. So we're here to help you kind of get your situation set up, whatever you're trying to audit.
Oh, well, that is great to hear on all fronts, especially because there is a lot of power in that knowledge of what people are booking, when they're booking, and you know, that information could be quite, you know, important to certain parties.
We have it. We have it, but no, we're not here to, we don't want to make money that way. Yeah, no. We're not here to make money that way. All the information that we're collecting is very, very important to you. So we have your login information. We have the website you're trying to automate. We have all these security details about you. And we want to make sure that that's only accessible to you and the botted team. So no one else can get access to it. We're not going to sell your information to third parties to make a dollar. Like, that's not what we're involved in. And we don't want to do that for with our service. And that's honestly, we've been successful without doing that. So that's something that we look to continue to do to make sure we're growing in that way and not try to sell ourselves for an extra dollar. So we're excited about what Bodit holds for the future. And we're going to continue to do that from a safe standpoint and not sell information. Make sure you're protected. Make sure all of your data is not being accessed by some random party. All of it's internal and all of it's safe. And we're here to continue to do that as long as we can.
I'm glad to hear that. And that, you know, that comes from somebody who would know computers for such a long period of time to understand that, how the importance of that, because a lot of it is trust, right?
Sure.
That is what IT is really all about, because anything is really, with enough time, anything is accessible. So speaking of being accessible, how can people get Bodit themselves?
Yeah. So they,
I was going to say you can visit our website, bodit.com. We also have a iOS app that you can use as well. So those are the best ways to set up your first.
Say, for example, you're looking to set up, I know we like to use, camping. Camping is perfect. So say you're looking to set up a camping reservation and you want to automate your camping reservation using our service. You go to our website, you sign up. You sign up and you set up your bot, then you pay for the subscription in order for your bot to run. So, and if you have any questions about setting up a bot or how does it work, we can customize and set up the bot for you with no problem at all. And most of our bots, when you can select it from a list, you can set up and start automating in seconds. That's the big difference maker from what Bodit is doing versus, you know, other things that make you go through a long process of setting up a bot, or you got to download some third party tool. This is built for the everyday people, the person who is a nurse and they have four kids, they want to set up a camping reservation, but they keep getting outbeat by bots. This is the person who owns a logistics company, but there are other companies out there that are automating services that they don't get the information that they can because a bot is doing it for a bigger company. So we are for the common person, and we're here to fight for the common person. We'll make sure that we work specifically with you. So go to our website. Even if you don't see the example, like camping, golf, pickleball, tennis, even if you don't see those examples, we still can build it for you. Just let us know. You can reach out to our support email, which is info@bodit.com. info@bodit.com. You can just you can say that, you know, you can tell that you saw this on Joe's podcast, and we'll make sure that we take care of you. Make sure we'll get Joe's viewers very, very special treatment if they go through our service, and make sure that we get you all set up.
So I got thank you. I got two questions for you. One, this video, like this here, it says Brian Owen. That's actually the name of one of the people that I talked about earlier in the podcast.
Oh, really?
Like, so is that like a random name that was put random together?
No, that's completely random. Brian Owen.
I'm gonna let him know that when I talk to him afterwards.
Wait, so that's the name of the person who you said set up the hotel bot last year with someone else?
Or yeah, yes, it is actually.
That's so. Oh. That must be a weird coincidence. That must be a sign. Yeah. That must be a sign.
Yeah, that's very, very random. We wanted to make sure we picked the most generic names that we ever did. So you might see a John Smith, Bob Jones or something like that. Like, yeah. Right.
What was I gonna say? Oh, the other question was, so on this automate camping reservations, right? Or tee times, is it specific to certain like campgrounds or certain outlets?
long as it's accessible on the web right now. So these are questions that are rolling in, which is a great question, Joe. So our service right now works specifically with websites. So as long as the bot can access a website, www.whatever.com, we're able to automate that for you. Now, there are some applications out there that they want to automate that's only in-app, like they want to use a iOS app or Android app. We do support that, but we haven't launched that to the public yet. Okay. So that's something that we are going to hopefully be launching in the near future to automate native apps. But for right now, to answer your question, if we can automate anything as long as the bot can access it online.
And okay, so then hotel reservations could be a thing?
Absolutely. We do that all the time.
All right, cool. Well, yeah. Then I got a hotel for you guys to book today.
There you go. You just finish the details and we'll get all that set up for you.
Awesome. Let's make that happen. Guys, I really appreciate you taking the time to come on and share, talk about bots, talk about technology, talk about business, talk about Shark Tank. It's been an absolute pleasure. You guys are welcome back anytime. You guys have something else, you know, updates or anything like that to come on. So just let me know. It'd be my pleasure to have you back.
Absolutely. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having us. Thank you. For sure. Thank you.
Bot.com. Check it out.
Yes, absolutely. And I appreciate you making it all the way to the end of this video. So if you haven't checked out their pitch, click on between them. If not, click over here. Maybe one of them over here. It gets weird with three screens. And go check out their pitch. And I'll see you in the opposite window. And take care and go be super.